All right, guys. So I wanted to have a quick discussion, and I wanted to add on to a little bit of my video last night. As you can tell, this is going to be a very Lonzo-centric video, and this video is going to talk about some of the things that I've noticed with the other people on the team being out. Okay? So let's talk about it. First of all, let me reiterate or say something that I neglected to mention last night, but I think is important to mention for the context of this video and as far as my video from last night. Keep in mind, people, that yes, some of these guys that they've got playing on a team, even though they're in the G League, they're not necessarily running the exact same sets or the exact same offense and defense. And even with that being said, just because you played with them in the preseason, it's been 27 games, I believe, since then. It's not the same. It is not the same. And that's a chemistry issue. When you're used to playing with certain guys and you know where they're going to be on the court, yada, 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 it makes the game, it's a different approach, different feel for the game that isn't normally there. So we've seen some turnovers that are uncharacteristic by some of these guys, like Lonzo. He had 5 this game, and I think he had like 4 or 5 the last game too. I know the turnovers have been bad, but you know, some of that too is like, damn, you know, you got a whole bunch of guys that you're not used to playing with. You know, Dotson, Troy Brown is actually in the rotation now. He's actually getting minutes and stuff, and now you got to figure out, you know, where he's going to be at. Matt Thomas. You know, some of these other guys, you know, you're used to Javonte Green, DeRozan, and Caruso. And so you kind of get you got a feeling of where they're going to be. Some of these other guys are being put into positions and asked to do more when they never have had to do more. And so that's going to lead to some disruption on the offense and defense. And I would be very remiss not to mention that at all as far as what the team is doing and what they're lacking right now. Of course, that won't last long. We understand these guys mostly are on COVID protocols, with the exception of Caruso. And so we expect to see some of them back within the next week and a half or so. So that's number one. Now, what I want to talk about is Lonzo and the effect or his numbers based on, you know, some of the shuffling of the lineups. So currently, this is what the team would have somewhat looked like last, well, you know, before they signed, made the DeRozan signing. Vooch, Zoe, Zach. I'm sorry about that. Zoe, Vooch, Zach. And then they probably would have kept Thaddeus Young and a couple of other pieces and probably got some other support pieces along with having Caruso. But the framework of what they would look like and play like is there. One thing I want people to take a note of is this is the first time he's played with a stretch five since Brook Lopez on the Los Angeles Lakers. And I don't know if you guys have noticed, but it's led to a lot of open lane for him to get into, which is one of the benefits of having, you know, Vooch on the team and in the lineup. It's a little bit harder to get into that paint when you got, you know, mama hips sitting out there clogging up the lane because, you know, motherfuckers just be sitting there taking up space for no fucking reason. But we've seen him be a lot more aggressive when Vooch is in there and it's like DeRozan missing versus when Tony Bradley is in there and, you know, you got DeRozan and Zach. Now, his scoring numbers, efficiency-wise, are better without DeRozan in there versus when Tony Bradley was there for Vooch. Now, that's not to say that DeRozan is pulling his numbers down. That's not what I'm trying to imply here. What I am trying to imply is having a stretch five benefits his game overall. And by the way, since DeRozan has been out and it's just been, you know, the three, He's been finishing at the rim at a pretty good clip. And I think that's something that we need to talk about and mention because, yes, his finishing has been pretty bad this year. And with Ayo, I think you're getting a little bit more spacing. And with Derrick Jones, you're getting a little bit more spacing. So now the floor has opened up for him. But his role has changed too because now he's being relied on as the third scorer. And he's pulling his weight the last two games. 20 points the previous game, 19 here. Okay, granted, it's two games, but he's pulling his weight. Now, earlier, he struggled the first couple of games, and then he had a pretty solid one, and then he was okay after that. But for the most part, he hasn't had it. Now, he is starting to regularly attack and finish, and it's making his numbers increase and look better. Now, let me pause here for a second. I really want to talk about something. Look, this expectation that Lonzo is going to be a scorer for this team when they're fully healthy has to go away. Okay? As you can tell, when someone, any one of the starters, the main guys anyway, is missing, his attack frequency increases. His usage rate increases. And so, yes, you get to see him attack the rim, take a couple more mid-range jump shots instead of just kind of camp out on the three-point line and play defense. Okay? He's kind of being used in a similar role in some lineups to his New Orleans role with Stan Van Gundy. And without it, it's kind of like a blend of, okay, we need him as 3 and D, and we need him as the ball handler. He's the first guy coming out to lead the second unit. He's the ball handler for the second unit. And again, this is a direct result of, okay, more has to be heaped on the zone because nobody else is there. Now, when you look at him, he's playing pretty good basketball. Like, there's some guys on my YouTube and all over the internet. Let me not just, you know, limit this. And they thought he probably could average 17, 18, 19 a game, maybe, you know, 7, 8 assists. It's looking like he probably could, to be honest. And I got to admit, I was skeptical. And I'm still a little skeptical of this. But with the attacks he's getting, the frequencies he's getting, and where his shots are coming from, and how effective he looks, I got to admit, he looks like he probably could put up 17 and 8. He looks like he probably could put that up. Now, I was more skeptical at me thinking he could put those numbers up as a fourth option, which clearly I've been correct on that. But there are some people that thought he would still be the third option anyway and put up those numbers. Now, I want to segue this here into a little bit of Vooch conversation. Vooch has been shit. I don't have a better way to put this. Vooch has been dog shit. He reminds me of Kevin Love when he went to the Cavs. Kevin Love used to average like a double-double. He would regularly put up like 25 and 12. He could shoot the lights out on a terrible Minnesota team. Goes to Cleveland, it just goes away. It just goes away. And this is what he's starting to remind me of. Okay? Now, Vooch does a couple of things that I think get underappreciated. He's a bailout guy in the middle of the court when there's a double team on your, you know, ball handler like a Zach LaVine or DeMar DeRozan. You give the ball to Vooch. Vooch is an excellent passer out the post. He sees the court very well. He's a release valve, okay? If you're going to consider trading Vooch, you lose that. If you don't get a guy back who can at least pass out the post and has some somewhat good court vision, you lose that. You lose the ability to get high-value playmaking from DeRozan and Zach LaVine's gravity. And I think that's something that needs to be talked about here because I'm one of the people that have been on the trade Vooch bandwagon. And that is something that I've thought about too. And for $22 million a year, I'm sorry, his productivity is not enough. But at the same time, you are going to miss his passing at the post if you don't get someone back like that. So then what does that mean? You're going to have to change up your offense. And I've heard the talks, Miles Turner. I get it. Trust me, I get it. And I would like Miles Turner too. And he's going to do more things for this team, I think, than Vooch would. For instance, he now shores up a defense in the center of the court, or in the paint rather, that was lacking. He's a little bit more athletic, okay? He's probably a little bit better on the boards. He may not be as good of a shooter from range as Vooch, but he has enough gravity to where he can make it work. These are some things you're going to have to weigh out when we're talking about a conversation of trading Vooch, okay? But again, we can't understate the value his presence is having on Lonzo being able to get to the paint, especially without DeRozan right now, and score effectively, okay? We've seen too many times now where he's attacked the paint, he's got up in there, he's finished, he just used his athletic ability, his natural speed, and got to the rim, which, again, would lead us to question something. Billy Donovan, what are you doing? Now, this isn't a video to suck off Lonzo. I know a lot of people are like, oh, you just hit it, touch it, it. No, but let's be real about this, okay? Let's be real. Vooch put up 24 shots last night, or 23. It was one of the two. And he only made like 7 or 8 shots, okay? Guy is Brick City right now as your third option. And he's been that way, you know, all year. And now as your second option, he's still Brick City. Meanwhile, Lonzo is showing at least to be a little bit more stable on the productivity side. When do you at some point start leaning more into Lonzo for scoring? That's the question. That's the elephant in the room for me. When do you start leaning more into Lonzo for scoring? And no, this isn't to hype up Lonzo, but let's be real. Last two games, Zoe's just been better. And even in the other games when he was still getting adapted to being put into that third option and having to play next to DeRozan and Zach LaVine, he just looked better. He just looked more stable as the third option. And while we're having this conversation, let's talk about something else too. Zach LaVine has been getting assists at a higher clip now recently. I'm not saying that DeMar DeRozan is the cause of this, but look, there's some evidence here, albeit not that much. We're going to need to see a bigger sample size for sure. And we're going to get to see that now that DeRozan for sure is going to be out for a 10-day size or a 10-day clip. And if I'm not mistaken, DeMar DeRozan comes back for the Miami game, the other Miami game that we play. It's either Miami or the Lakers. I think it's the Lakers. But he'll be back then. Yeah, it's the Lakers because it's LeBron. Okay, I remember that. So, yeah, he'll be back for that Lakers game. People, Zach is passing more effectively as far as getting assists. Zoe is scoring better. I know a lot of people have an issue. Hell, I had a follower unfollow me and express to me how bad my content was on my channel because of my statements about DeMar Vooch. God bless the person. I wish him well. Have a nice day. I'm not tripping. But here's the thing, people. Our backcourt is doing what they're supposed to do. It's the front court we have an issue with right now. And I'm not even including DeMar DeRozan in this. I'm putting DeMar to the side because really, DeMar is supposed to be a two guard anyway. He's playing out of position. The fact that he's even giving you 28 a game basically is fan-fucking-tastic. He's playing out of position. He's not a three. Hell, Zach been playing out of position the last two games. Because Ayo has been the two, and Zach is the small forward, which makes sense because AO is smaller and Zach is bigger. Have no issue with that. I have none at all with that. But here we are, the Bruins backcourt, as I have jokingly named him BBC. They're playing. Zach had a bad shooting night, still gave you 23. Lonzo gave you 19. That's 42. Previous game, I believe Zach had 32 and Lonzo gave you 20. That's what, 52? I mean, they're performing. People, this is what we were expecting, correct? This is why you signed Lonzo. This is why you paired him next to Zach, because you said, okay, this is the backcourt of the future. Shout outs to the New Orleans Pelicans. This is the backcourt of the future. This is why you paired them. This is why you put them together. And then I understand you also got AO, you got Caruso. That's your backcourt. Those are the guys you're going to battle with for the next 7 to 10 years. That's it. But the problem is that front court. The problem is the front court. We officially have 6 days, because today is the 9th, before we can trade players that were signed and acquisitions from this offseason. That is the date that we're waiting on. I know Miles Turner, Sabonis, a lot of these other guys on the Pacers, they're looking to go into a full rebuild. So there's going to be teams out there. Hey, yo, can we get this guy? What you looking for? What do you want from our team? That's going to happen. Bradley Beal recently said he's not concerned about signing an extension yet with the Wizards. Okay? There's some things rumbling here. And now, this sets up what is going to be an interesting next couple of weeks, because this is analysis time. If Vooch continues to play like shit without DeRozan there, and he's the second option, and Zach and Zoe are still producing, at what point do you say, okay, it's time to pack this thing up and go make a move? A lot of people are saying, hey, let's go trade Kobe. Let's go trade Pat. Let's go trade Troy Brown, Javante Green. I think consensus-wise, I think most everybody is okay with Derrick Jones Jr. I am too. I just don't like the fact that they're playing him at a small ball five. I really don't. Power forward, I have a little bit of issue with that, but the small ball lineups, I have no issue with it. At the three, great. I love him at the three. I love him at the three. I truly love him at the three. By the way, he's been playing better too now that he's getting starter minutes. But I know he played some serious minutes in Portland, so that don't shock me. Okay? He got some experience. But at some point, people, we got to take a serious look at this team. Zach LaVine is still doing Zach LaVine things. Okay? Albeit last night was a bad night. Understood. He's going to do him. He's going to do him. Okay? But this front court is a mess. We're at 9 losses on the season. Let me be real with y'all. The only losses that we should have had on this schedule, and I mean just straight beat down, was that first game for the Knicks, the Miami game, and the Golden State game. Those are the only 3 losses that I truly accept were losses that we should have had. All the other ones, we should have won. All the other ones, yes, including the Pacers, we should have won. And I'm thinking about this in context of if we had had the right pieces in the front court, those games we should have won. This team should be 23-3 right now. That's what we should be, in my view. Now, people are gonna sit here and split hairs and say, how can you say that, all that? This is just my opinion. This is not something for you guys to say, oh, he's saying this as a matter of fact. This is just my view on it. You don't have to agree. I don't really care what your premise or thought process is on it anyway. This is strictly my viewpoint. This team should be 23-3 right now. And the next couple of weeks are going to be very fucking telling. If Vooch can't turn this shit around, I mean, you can't just have two good games and then go back to this shit. He is going to have to put on like a month worth of like Vooch. Like the Vooch I've seen him in as in Orlando. He's going to have to put it on for like a month before I'm like, okay. Because right now, since the season started in October, here we are in December, and you mean to tell me he's only had probably in total four decent games? Two good games, one good game. Well, let me take that back. Two great games, one good game, and a decent game. That's all I can remember. That's all I can remember, people. You mean to tell me that's it? Now, I know he missed those games with the COVID shit. I get it. I'm not tripping. I understand. But my God, are we serious about this right now? Of the 18 to 17 games he's played, are you telling me that he was only good for like three or four of those games? We can't get any better productivity from our five? And it's not like, I get it if he was just having a shooting slump. He's having a scoring slump, man. He's missing bunnies. Layups, he's missing it all, man. It's just not there. And so at some point, like I said, this is not a video to slander DeMar DeRozan or Nikola Vucevic. This is not a video to hype up Zoe above everybody else. This is a video to just be real. Zoe has been basically what was advertised. And especially without DeMar DeRozan in a lot of, he's definitely been what was advertised. Zach LaVine has been what was advertised. Actually, he's been a little bit better. He's been a little bit better on defense. Better on ball defender, just shitty off ball. But yes, he's had his moments where he's been, you know, bad on ball too. But for the most part, he's kept his guy in front of him. It's about all you can ask for. And without Pat Will, who I had questions about at the four, I mean, we just don't have it. And when you see a team like Cleveland, it's just like, oh, there it is. They just take over and wipe you off the floor. Imagine what happens when we play the Bucks. So this is where we're at, people. I hope this crystallizes and explains things for you all for where I am coming from. Like I said, I think our backcourt is secure for the next couple years. I'm not worried about the backcourt. It's just the front court. I don't know what options you can go for. Let me just say this. Sabonis is not it, guys. He's not it. Yes, he can pass, but he can't shoot anyway. I mean, yeah, he can get boards and stuff, but he's not going to be any better than Vooch is in the paint. And so guess what? Teams are still going to go and attack us in the paint. We definitely need some more athleticism. And so I would rather have Jackson Hayes on this team. I'm not saying starting, but I would much rather have him on the team, at least on the bench. I would be okay with having Miles Turner start. I have no issue with that. There's not too many, you know, guys who as a center can pass, you know, within the post and make the proper reads. There's some guys, but not a lot. Okay, so to lose Vooch is going to be a huge blow in certain aspects of our offense. But the upgrades on defense might very well offset that, okay? And, you know, you might just have to play through not having that bailout guy in the center. I still like DeRozan in the playoffs. I think that's where he is going to get the most value for this team, is when buckets get harder to come by and you need to put the ball in the hole. I think that's where he will actually benefit this team the most. And I think that's also where Zoe will benefit us the most too. We need those small micro plays and the spacing that he provides that, you know, gets a little bit more opening for, you know, DeRozan and Zach to work. I think that's where his value will especially be high. And his defense, of course. But right now, our front court is abysmal. Like I said, our back court has been great. They have been as good as advertised. I have no issue with that. They could be better, for sure. But they have been as advertised. It's that fucking front court, man. It's that freaking front court. Billy Donovan, you got some decisions to make. You and Acme, a.k.a. Mark Eversley. Don't wait too long. Stand on your convictions and do what you got to do. If you back Vooch, I have no problem with you backing Vooch. If you don't think that there's enough value out there that you can replace him with, keep him. I have no issue with that. I understand. But, man, we got to do something about that power forward position, because we can't keep this up. We just can't. And all this undersized four shit that people are okay with, you saw it when we played Cleveland. What did it get us? I'll let y'all consider that and think about that. Anyway, y'all have a good day. It's your boy. I'll catch y'all later. Peace.